This is Fred Foy. Join us now as we travel back in time and relive some of the magic that was part of the golden age of radio. It's time now for another episode of The Glowing Dial here on Yesterday USA.
How? Quiet, numbskulls. I'm broadcasting. Use Gritto, radio friends. The soap that gives your hands that dishpan look. How will the old man know you've been working if your hands don't have that dishpan look? Put a box of Gritto in a glass of water, then listen to it fizz. Dopes. Remember, Gritto spelled sideways is Otrigger. And now Gritto's own story of Sandra Sandpile, and here's Mud in Your Eye. Music.
I heard you on the wireless back in 52, lying awake intently tuning in on you. If I was young, it didn't stop you coming through.
And now the hosts of The Glowing Dial, Big John and Steve.
Hello, everybody. Thank you very much, Fred Foy. And how are you doing? Welcome, Mr. Urbanic. How are you?
Hi, John. How are you today?
Welcome to another edition of The Glowing Dial here on Yesterday USA Superstation. The station founded by your friend, my friend, the man with a million friends, Mr. Bill Bragg. Down in Richardson, Texas. We hope he's, as always, doing okay. And happy 2000, folks, as we record this episode here away from our normal studio. We're on the portable system here today, but as you hear this, it will have turned into what some call the new millennium. Some say it doesn't start till 2001. What an odyssey that'll be. Yeah.
You did that on Kubrick, I see.
Yeah, it's real tough without a rim shot, you know, but...
So do we call this year OO?
Yes, Stanley.
If last year was 99, then this year would be OO?
Well, you see, at this point in time, as we're recording this, we don't know whether the clocks turning over to OO have caused anybody any problem, but we hope not. So we hope you have power and food and water and everything while you're listening to the program. If not, then I guess you're not listening to the program. But anyway, welcome to the show. We're glad to be back with you, as always. And we got a couple interesting programs for you this time around. We have a Laurel and Hardy show for you that was it was an audition program. And the title of the episode is called Mr. Slater's Poultry Market.
Where did you dig this one up? I didn't remember you having this one before.
FOTR, my friend. Yes, The Friends of Old Time Radio Convention Dealer's Room is just chock full of goody, goody, goody stuff. And we here at The Glowing Dial are after better and better quality sounding shows these days. And I'm trying to switch our archives around as much as I can and pull the good stuff, put it on a separate list on our website so you know what's going on. And you know what anything on our premium list on the website you know is going to be a very, very good quality sound.
Do we have Ethel on our premium
from
list?
From CD too? Masters, of course. So
do we have that? Do we have that, John? We have Ethel on our premium list?
No, we don't even have Fred.
Oh, well, it would be a gas if we did.
Mm-hmm. Give me Ethel. If Ethel's out, get Phyllis. If Phyllis is gone, get Mabel.
Black Label.
Yeah, there you go. I knew you were going into the beer commercial. I just knew it.
Right.
Anyway, this is...
Any better than Muriel and the Cigars there?
Yeah.
Muriel.
This is from March 6th of 1944, Laurel and Hardy.
That's later
here.
For them, isn't it? A bit. It's pretty much later than most of the other stuff. So it's one.
Yeah, it is. Well, you know, this is some of the very little stuff they actually did in radio. They didn't do a whole lot.
Right.
And this was an audition, but since the boys were so visual in their comedy, that's why they didn't work too well on radio.
Yeah. You couldn't see a lot of their
facial
expressions.
And I assume that's why the Stooges didn't do any radio that
probably.
I know of.
Yeah.
Because they were so incredibly visual. Abbott and Costello did well because their routines were verbal as well.
Right. They
see,
did
they
better
had
on
these
that,
spoken
right.
routines that, you know, who's on first, the mutter and fodder and all that stuff. That's why they succeeded on radio much better. Anyway, why don't we get going here into the program. And again, from March 6, 1944, Laurel and Hardy Show audition, Mr. Slater's Poultry Market. Enjoy.
The National Broadcasting Company presents the Laurel and Hardy Show. Here on the home front, a pledge is being taken, a pledge that'll stamp out the black market once and for all. This is the pledge. I will pay no more than top legal prices. I will accept no ration goods without giving up ration points. Now, this simple statement, a pledge already taken by 15 million Americans, is helping to do these three important things. It will automatically kill the black markets. It'll ensure a fair share of food for all, civilians, fighting men, and fighting allies, and it'll help keep down the cost of living. If you are one of the 15 million Americans who've already taken this pledge, then live up to it. If you haven't, take the pledge now. Share and play square. It's the American way. Laurel and Hardy have decided to embark upon new careers, and now they are working for Mr. Slater's Poultry Market. In this way, the boys are doing their bit to relieve the manpower shortage. That is, if you can consider Laurel and Hardy manpower.
Miss Smith.
Yes, Mr. Slater.
Where's Laurel and Hardy?
You sent them out to deliver a chicken.
But that was hours ago, and this is one of my busiest days.
I can't understand why they're not back yet, Mr. Slater.
What can anybody understand about Laurel and Hardy? This is a fine how-do-you-do. With everything else to contend with, now I've got to send two men to deliver one chicken.
I know what you mean, Mr. Slater.
Well, as soon as they get back, send them in to me.
Ollie.
Yes, Stanley.
I bet Mr. Slater will be pleased with the way we handed this job.
He certainly will. That Mr. Cunningham couldn't put anything over on us.
I should say not. Here's Mr. Slater's poultry market now. Let's go in and tell him all about it.
Miss Smith, where are those two boobs?
Ollie, I think Mr. Slater is looking for us.
Oh, there you are. Well, did you deliver the chicken?
Of course, sir. Did you have any doubts?
Plenty. And did you collect the money for the chicken, like I said?
Oh, we did much better than that.
Oh, so you did better than that.
Yeah, go ahead and tell him, Ollie.
Yes, go ahead. Tell me.
Mr. Cunningham thought that he could outsmart us.
But we were very much too clever for him.
So you were too clever for him, huh? Well, just what did you do?
Well, Mr. Cunningham insisted on charging the chicken.
Charge it? I distinctly told you his credit is no good. And you let him sign for it again.
Oh, no, we didn't.
He wanted to sign for it, but he couldn't fool us.
I signed for it myself.
You signed for it?
And remember the $16 he owed you for the other chickens?
This is going to be good.
Sure. We added it all up together.
And you signed for that, too.
Exactly. Now, what do you think of us, Mr. Slater?
I bet you thought we couldn't do it.
You nincompoops. You stupid blunderheads. You idiotic. You
morons.
Morons. I had a feeling when I hired you that I'd regret it the rest of my days.
Oh, we worked nights, too.
Now listen to me, you mental midgets. I'm going to give you one more chance. The customer is waiting for this chicken, but if you come back without the money, I'll break every bone in your head.
In a cheap, smoke-filled hotel room on the east side are three sinister men. These men are dangerous criminals, wanted by every police department in the land. The air is tense. The men pace nervously, their faces grim, as they await the arrival of two hired killers from out of town.
Andy ought to be here by now. I wonder what's keeping them.
All right. Take it easy, will you, Mike? They'll be here.
I don't get it. What's the chief importing these two killers for? Hey, we've been doing all right.
Now, look, you guys, this is a special job. That's why the chief is bringing in these torpedoes.
Yeah, didn't we wipe out the Murphy mob? What was the matter with that?
Yeah, but this is different. The chief don't want no slip-ups on this one. These guys rubbed out Louis Kerrigan.
You mean these are the guys that bumped off Kerrigan?
Yeah, and the cops couldn't find a clue either.
What do they look like, Cobra?
Are you kidding? These killers are smart. Nobody knows what they look like.
Hey, wait a minute. There's two guys coming across the street now. Look out the window.
Yeah, that's them. Black derbies, the chief said.
Wow, tough-looking gorillas, ain't they?
Oh. You ain't kidding, so you better get down and meet them, Steve.
Okay.
Ollie?
Yes, Stanley?
Are you sure this is the right address?
Of course I'm sure, Stanley. I distinctly remember Mr. Slater saying to deliver the chicken to 703 Maple Street.
Oh, I thought he said 307 April Street.
Will you let me handle this? I'll do the thinking on this job.
Yeah, but Ollie, you did the thinking on the last job.
Will you be quiet? Now remember what Mr. Slater said. We're not to leave the chicken unless we get the money for it.
That's right. No credit.
Hey, Stanley.
What?
I think that man wants to speak to us.
Okay, fellas, follow me. We'll go up the back way.
Of course. We intended to go to the rear entrance.
Right in here. Yeah, touchy guys is never going to get here.
We never disappoint a customer.
Well, our motto is...
Be still, Stanley.
I guess we don't use our motto anymore, you see.
Hey, Mike, pull down that shade.
Okay.
You want to get these guys away? Now, remember, you guys, first you make the delivery, and then later you get the payoff.
Now, just one moment. There'll be no delivery until you pay the money.
Now, wait a minute. We always get delivery and pay later.
Oh, no, none of that. No. No credit. No. Oh, no, you don't. No.
Stanley!
Oh, no.
You mean no.
N-O, no.
Will you keep quiet, Stanley?
But those were the chief's instructions.
The chief?
Yeah, I guess that's what they call the man who's going to pay us the money.
Yeah, that's right. We don't use names in deals like this.
Where is the chief?
Oh, he'll be here, just as agreed. First, you got to deliver the goods.
Well, that's why we're here.
You mean you killed that bird already?
Sure, about an hour ago.
How do you like that?
You guys sure move fast. The chief didn't expect you to work that quick.
If I ain't too inquisitive, how do you pros work? Do you kill them with a regular 45 rod?
Oh, no, sir. On this one, we use the standard 14-inch butcher knife.
Butcher knife?
Don't they put up a fight?
Oh, yeah. Sometimes they put up a terrible struggle.
Hey, what do you do then?
Ollie holds them by the feet.
By the feet?
Yeah, and then Stanley takes the axe and chops off the head.
Chops off the head?
Relax.
Sure, we try to be as gentle as possible.
But ain't that kind of gruesome?
Oh, after a while, you get used to it. It doesn't mean a thing to us now, does it, Stanley?
I should say not. You know, we kill as many as 24 a day.
What?
Well, now, that would be on Saturday, of course.
Oh, yes, of course, of course.
Sure, Saturdays and holidays are our busiest times.
Must be an awful strain on you.
Oh, no, the strain is on them.
Hey, these guys ain't human.
Tell me, what do you do with the body?
Well, now, that depends. Sometimes we deliver them to the customers just as they are.
Oh.
Yeah, but when we get a tough one...
Yeah?
We dip it in boiling water.
That softens them up considerably.
Oh.
Look, what's the matter, Mike? What's the matter?
He's white as a sheet.
Oh.
This has been too much for him.
Perhaps he's a little faint. Here, my good man, let me help you.
Get him away from me. Don't let him touch me.
Here, have a chair, Mike. Sit down. Get him a cold towel,
Corporal. All right, here. Relax now, Mike. Take it easy. Hey, what's that?
The cops are pulling up in front.
Well, come on. Let's get out of there, quick.
Well, they ran away without taking their chicken.
Do you think we said something wrong, Ollie?
I don't think so, Stanley.
Here they are, men.
Wait a minute. What is this? Everything we've had here.
Hardy in just a minute. Now here's Thomas Peluso and the orchestra playing Thanks for the Dream. Housewives, here's a message for you. A new simplified plan for the rationing of processed foods, meats, fats, and oils has now been put into operation. This new plan is designed to simplify rationing for consumer and dealer alike and cut down on shopping time. Here's the way it works. Your blue and red stamps in War Ration Book 4 now have a value of 10 points. The number on the stamp no longer indicates the point value. The blue stamps will be used for processed food only, and the red stamps will be used for meats, fats, and oils. Blue and red tokens worth 1 point each will be given as change by dealers when change is required. There's no time limit on these tokens, and the blue and red stamps will now have a longer validity period of about 12 weeks. That's all there is to it, just a new and simple change in the rationing system. Now back to Laurel and Hardy, who seem to have gotten themselves into a bit of trouble. Mistaken for two dangerous killers and closely guarded by the police, Laurel and Hardy have been ushered into the city jail. But obviously, the boys don't seem to be quite sure of what it's all about yet.
Just picked up those two trigger men, Sergeant.
Okay. Come on, bring them in.
Bring them in, Johnson.
Get in there, you two.
They mean us, Stanley.
Get over there to the desk.
I guess you guys were thinking you could get away with this, huh?
Oh, no. Ollie's doing the thinking on this job.
Oh. Oh, I see. The fat guy. I figured you were the brains the minute I spotted you.
Well, now that you mention it, officer, people often remark that I have a very intelligent-looking face.
Is he kidding?
All right. Come on, search him, Murphy.
Come here, you. One Boy Scout knife. One what? No work in it. 12 cents. Three bottle tops. That's all, Sergeant.
Okay, now search the little guy.
All right. Hey, there's nothing but holes in this guy's pocket. Wait a minute. What are you holding in your hand?
Which hand?
Come on, let's have it.
Come on, what do you got there? Let's see it.
Oh, that's my yo-yo, officer.
Yo-yo.
Murphy, take them downstairs and throw them in a cell. These guys must be psychopathic killers.
Okay, you guys, get in this cell.
Thank you very much, officer. Come along, Stanley.
The service is nice here, isn't it, Dolly?
We're so very glad you like it. We aim to please our guests.
This is a cozy little place, isn't it?
Hmm.
Maybe it's because you're in here, too, Ollie.
Do you mind if I lock the door? House regulation, you know.
Oh, no, not at all. Go right ahead.
Could we have an extra key?
You see, Stanley likes to take a short walk before bedtime.
Now, isn't that a shame? I don't have an extra key with me, but I'll tell the sergeant to be sure and have one made for you.
Ollie.
Yes, Stanley?
Do you feel hungry?
Yeah, I believe that I could do with a little snack.
Gee, I'd like a meal like this served to the man in the next cell.
You mean the man who's leaving?
What's he going away?
Is he going away? Didn't you hear them say that they were giving him his last supper?
He must like it here. He seemed very unhappy about leaving.
Shall we order dinner now, Stanley?
I don't see why not, Ollie.
Officer! Oh, officer!
Room service!
Yeah, what's going on? Come on, what's all the noise about?
We'd like to place our order for dinner, please.
Oh, you'd like to place your order for dinner?
Sure, we eat very regular and we don't like our routine broken.
Oh, no. No, of course not. We mustn't do that.
I believe that steaks would be nice. Don't you think so, Stanley?
I think so. Yeah. I believe a steak would be nice. Make mine a thick one.
Yeah. Make that two, officer.
Two?
Not too thick.
Two thick steaks.
Yeah, but he doesn't want it too thick.
I think I'd like it medium. No, I think... No, I think I'd rather have it rare.
Yeah, I see.
Why don't you try it medium rare?
Now, that's a very good idea. Make mine the same.
Wouldn't you like some dessert, too?
We'll decide about that later. Just bring in the steaks now, my good man.
Oh, gentlemen, I just happened to remember we're fresh out of steaks. But in the meantime, here's our blue plate special for today. Bread and water!
In a cold gray room of the city jail, three grim detectives are relentlessly grilling their two suspects, Laurel and Hardy. The two boys are seated under the merciless glare of an arc lamp, while the detectives fire away at them. The third degree has been going on for 5 hours now, but strangely enough, the detectives seem to be more exhausted than their captives.
For the last time, are you guys going to confess or not?
Come on, spill it. You'll sit under that hot light all week.
We've been easy on you guys, but we can get rough.
Now, really, gentlemen, this whole thing is a mistake. We don't have the least idea of what you're talking about.
Maybe perhaps if we came back some other time.
You're going to stay right here. We know who you are. We've got you dead to rights. Now, talk.
Yes, sir. The man wants us to talk, Stanley.
All right. What would you like to talk about, Oliver?
I don't know. What would you like to talk about, Stanley?
Oh, I don't care. Anything you want to talk... Let's talk about...
Now listen, you mug! I'm going to give you one more chance. Start singing!
Singing?
Come on.
Why, we'd be delighted. Mizzy Dose and Dozy Dose and Little Lambsy Tidy.
Shut up!
Tiddly winks and winky tiddles and tiddle and tivy and two and wooden shoes or something.
That's enough! Now look, you two,
Wait a minute, Donovan.
Wait a minute, I've got an idea.
What?
Come over here.
I wonder why they're mad at us, Ollie.
Why should they arrest us?
It's probably that Mr. Kingsley. He was very angry because you didn't deliver his chicken.
Well, it served him right for calling me a nerk.
He didn't call you a nerk, Stanley. He called you a jerk.
Oh, well, that's different. Maybe I shouldn't be mad at him. I shouldn't be mad at him.
Say, does this strong light bother you, Stanley?
No, Ollie, but I've got an awful kink in my neck from sitting in this chair so long.
Mm. Here, Stanley, sit closer to the lamp. The heat will do your neck good.
Thank you, Ollie. Pointed towards my apple.
Mm. Say, I wonder what they're whispering about over there.
Now, look, man. We've been grilling these dudes for 5 hours, and we haven't broken them yet.
Yeah. Can't stand them much longer. I'm cracking up.
Yeah, me too. My nerves are all shot to pieces. I'd like to murder the both of them.
No, that's where you boys are wrong. Mm. These guys aren't just ordinary mugs. They're clever. They're putting on the dumb act. We've got to outsmart them.
So what do we do? Act dumb, too?
Of course we don't act dumb. We got to use psychology on them.
Yeah, I get it. Use brains against brains.
Right.
Yeah.
Now, first, I'll use the friendly approach.
Yeah.
If that doesn't work, we'll break down their nerves.
Fine.
You got the file ready, Donovan?
Yeah, right here.
Okay. Now, when I give you the word, start filing on that iron bar, steady and monotonous-like. That ought to drive them crazy. Brickhouse,
yeah.
You'll be ready with the water. Let's go.
Well, look, boys, you've got us all wrong. We're just trying to help you. All we want is a little information. We know that you boys didn't want to do all those killings, did you?
No, sir, but we got so many orders, so we had to do them.
And after all, business is business.
Of course it is. Now, you see, Brickhouse, I told you there were a couple of nice boys. Now tell me, boys, who were the parties that ordered them killed?
Oh, we're very sorry, but we can't divulge that.
So you still won't confess?
Well, our customer list is very confidential. Somebody might cut in on our business.
We'd really like to tell you, sir, but it's a professional secret.
Okay, Donovan.
Ollie, that sound.
Can't stand it, can ya?
Oh, I don't mind it. It just reminds me I'd like to borrow Ollie's fingernail file.
Here you are, Stanley, and be careful of your cuticle.
Go ahead, Brickhouse.
Wouldn't you like a nice, cool drink of water?
Oh, no, thank you, sir.
I'm not a bit thirsty either.
Here, Brickhouse, give it to me. I need it bad.
Oh, that's better.
Donovan, will you stop that noise? You're driving me nuts.
I was driving myself nuts.
Now you listen to me, you two gorillas.
I want to know where you were at 12:30 yesterday. Now, come on and quit stalling.
12:30. Now, let me see.
Ollie, wasn't that when we stopped?
No, Stanley, that was 2 o'clock. At 12:30, we were going to kill,
Yes. You were saying you were going to kill...
No, but we didn't do it.
That's right. Mr. Jones wouldn't pay the ceiling price.
Ah, they didn't cut ceiling prices.
Of course, we wouldn't want to break the law.
No, we're getting someplace. I suppose this was one of the Kerrigan bunch you were going to kill yesterday.
Kerrigan?
Yes.
I never heard of them, have you, Ollie?
Mm-mm. No, we were going to kill an ordinary leghorn.
Yep.
Must be an out-of-town mob.
Well, we don't care where they come from.
I've never heard anything like this as long as I've been on the force. How many do you figure you've killed altogether?
Oh, hundreds. We don't count them.
Hundreds!
Yeah, you see, business is picked up because we don't require ration points.
Point. Now listen to me, wise guys. Don't try to get killed.
Take it easy.
18 years on the boat, but I never come up against anything like this.
Calm down.
Don't worry about me. I'm okay, boys. I'm okay. Don't worry about me.
There's only one thing to do. We'll question them one at a time.
Yeah.
Get up here, you.
Oh, me?
Yeah, you. Stand here next to me.
I'll take care of you next. Now, listen, Hardy.
Yes, sir.
You may as well spill the whole thing. We've got to cold. On the day before yesterday, what were your movements? Just what were you doing?
Yes, Ollie. Just what were you doing?
Why, Stanley, I was with...
Yes, yes. Who were you with?
Stanley, you know perfectly well that I was with you.
Oh, that's right. He was with me.
I don't care. I'm going to quit. I'll give up prevention against standing anymore.
Grab him, Brickhouse. He's strong in the mouth. Grab him.
Calm down, Lieutenant. Just go to the police. Go to the police. Calm down, calm down. There's his telephone.
Hello? Yes, Chief? Uh-huh. Okay, Chief. Well, we can let him go, boys. The chief says the whole thing was a mistake. They picked up the real killers at the railroad station.
You mean we can get rid of these two?
That's right. The chief says they're as harmless as a couple of babes.
Harmless as a couple of babes?
Now get out of here, you two. Get out before I tear you apart with my bare hands.
Come on, Stanley. I don't think the man wants us here.
Pardon me, sir, but would you mind if I stayed a few minutes longer so the lamp can bake the other side of my neck?
He's got a bad kink in it.
Kink in it? I'll put a break in it. I'll.
The lieutenant's gone nuts. Throw them out, quick.
Get out, you two. Get out.
He certainly was a tempestuous man, wasn't he, Stanley?
He sure was. And he had a bad temper, too. Say, Ollie.
What?
I wonder if we said anything to upset him.
How could we possibly upset anyone?
Hardy will be back in just a moment. But first, no one needs to tell us what the Marines are doing in this war. It's written in every headline. We can see it in every newsreel. The Marines are in there fighting to the last man. America needs more of these fighting men, and one way to get them is for women to enlist in the Marine Corps to release a man for active duty. Thousands of women are needed now in our Marine Corps. You'll have an opportunity to serve in a vital, interesting job. You'll receive the same pay and advantages of the men in the armed forces, and you'll be receiving valuable training for post-war activities. Become a woman Marine and free a Marine to fight. It's just about time to say goodbye for all of us here, Thomas Peluso and his orchestra, and yours truly, Doug Gourley. But we can't go before we see what's happened to Laurel and Hardy.
Come along, Stanley. Let's hurry back to Mr. Slater's market.
But, Ollie...
What is it?
We don't have the chicken.
Don't you suppose that I know that, Stanley?
Yeah, but Ollie...
Well, what do you want now?
We don't have the money either.
Oh, yes, we have.
Oh, no, we haven't.
Oh, yes, we have.
Oh, no, we haven't.
Oh, yes, we have.
I beg your pardon. Pardon.
Naturally, Laurel and Hardy can never face Mr. Slater again. So right in front of them is Morton's Plumbing Shop. I wonder if they can land the job.
Hello,
Laurel and Hardy Show is presented in Hollywood. This is the National Broadcasting Company. Good ladles, evening and gentlemen. This is Jay Ronburn inviting you to hear the Gliling Dough. I mean the Dueling Glile. Well, you know. It's the best in old raid timey-o with Big Ston and Jeeve. Don't Dutch that tile.
We certainly won't. Thank you, Mr. Rayburn. Hello, everybody. We're back with you, Big John and Steve. Hope you enjoyed the Laurel and Hardy Show. Mr. Slater's Poultry Market from March 6, 1944. You know, Steve, it sounded like with that show that they were going to do from week to week, Laurel and Hardy in a different job.
Mm-hmm.
And screwing it up somehow.
Like the Three Stooges had different jobs every time you turn around, too.
Yeah, and that's what the Three Stooges TV show, which was never aired. In 1949, I think they did one for ABC, a pilot. Never got shown. Milton Berle's brother, Phil, produced it. And it never got went any further than that because their home studio, Columbia Pictures, said that their contract did not allow them to do outside projects like that without approval. So it survives today in a very, very bad kinescope that has been, like, dubbed over 25 times. But still, it is still somewhat watchable and a great piece of history if anybody out there has not seen that. Let me know. Maybe I can arrange to trade you something for it. But anyway, back to the program.
In the year of uh-oh.
Uh-oh.
Uh-oh. Maybe it's the year of goose egg. Maybe it's goose eggs.
Yeah.
Two zeros is, you know, goose eggs. So we got double. We got two goose eggs.
Actually, three.
Yeah,
there are three of them in 2000, aren't there?
There'd be three goose
eggs.
So
I guess we should say, oh, oh, oh.
Oh, oh, wow, oh, wow.
Now we sound like a vintage group harmony or something here.
I just don't know what they're going to call it. Or the decade. It was the 90s. Now is it going to be the O's? The O's? I have no idea.
That's a good question. I don't know.
We usually have names for the decades.
Probably the 2000s or something.
The 2000s.
The second millennia or...
The turn of the millennia. I don't know what they're going to call it.
Actually, it'll be the third, wouldn't it?
Turn of the millennia, right. Instead of
the
turn of the century.
0 to 999 would be the first one, right?
Yeah, turn of the millennia. It's the... I don't know. It's weird.
If anybody has any idea what to call the new decade, write to us at the Glowing Dial. We'll give you that at the end of the show, folks.
Actually, we're talking about weird. That happens to have something to do with the next
the
show
next
we're going to
have.
The
next show, The Strange Dr. Weird. Oh, you have to go now. What a shame.
The Strange Dr. Weird, yes.
Yes.
This episode is number five.
Number five in the series.
The series. Huh? Death in the Everglades.
Ooh. Ooh.
And air date is December 5th, 1944.
From the Mutual Radio Network. So without further ado, we're going to get into that. So here's The Strange Dr. Weird, Death in the Everglades. Enjoy, and we'll be back.
Adam Hatz presents... The Strange Dr. Weird.
Good evening. Come in, won't you? You seem a bit nervous. Perhaps the cemetery outside this house has upset you. But there are things far worse than cemeteries. Such things as dark, forbidding swamps, stretching for hundreds of miles and inhabited by snakes, mosquitoes, and alligators, as in the story I want to tell you tonight. The story I call Death in the Everglades. The story begins in the vast shadowy wastes of the Florida Everglades. A small dugout glides through the dark swamp water, poled along by a weather-beaten guide. The guide's passengers, Gerald Drake and his wife Kitty, sit nervously in the center of the dugout, subdued by their strange and uncanny surroundings.
Gerald, how much further do we have to go? It's been 2 hours now since we left the mainland.
I'll see. Guide, how much further is it to my uncle's home?
It ain't much further. Just a small piece.
Gerald, are you sure your Uncle Jason has money?
Well, up until my mother died a year ago, Uncle Jason was sending her $500 a month. And he owns thousands of acres of valuable Florida property.
If he has money, why should he choose to live here all alone in these horrible swamps?
Because he's an eccentric.
Oh, Gerald, please, let's turn back. This horrible dark swamp with its alligators and snakes frightens me. I have a feeling that something dreadful will happen if we don't turn back.
Don't be a fool, Kitty. We can't turn back. We're broke, do you understand that? Uncle Jason is our last hope. We must go on.
Why have you come here, Gerald?
Well, after all, Uncle Jason, I am your only living relative, and, well, I wanted to find out how you were getting along.
Gerald worries about your living here alone in the swamp.
Oh, I'll always live here in the swamp, always. It's quiet and peaceful here, and I have my friends.
Your friends?
Yes. Didn't you see them as you came here, singing in the trees, swimming in the water? I know them all. They're my friends. They protect me from harm like true friends do.
Yes, of course, Uncle. I
know why you come here. You want money. That's why you come here, isn't it?
Well, yes. You see, Uncle Jason, we...
Get out! Get out, you hear? I won't give you a cent. Not a cent.
But, Uncle Jason, after all, you must remember that I'm your only...
Leave my house at once! Get out!
But we can't. The guide won't be back until 4 o'clock this afternoon to take us to the mainland.
Hey, well, then, you must stay here until he comes. I'm going out now, and when I come back at sundown, I don't want to find either of you here.
Gerald, what are you doing?
I'm trying to break the lock on this metal cash box.
Cash box?
Yes, my darling. A short talk with Uncle Jason convinced me that he kept his money someplace in this house. It wasn't too difficult to find his cash box.
But Gerald.
If my dear uncle won't part with his money willingly, he's going to have to part with it unwillingly.
My cash box! What are you doing with it?
Uncle Jason.
You're home a bit early, aren't you, Uncle Jason?
You're trying to rob me. You're like all the others. Well, I won't let you rob me. Give me my box. Give me my
box. I don't like to do this, Uncle Jason, but I must have that money, understand? Come on now.
You may kill me, but you'll never get away with my box.
Give me that.
I spend in the swamp. I'll see you don't. You'll never leave this swamp. Never you.
Very well, Uncle. If you insist.
Let go of him. Let go, you'll kill him.
That's exactly what I'm doing. You're the one who's never going to leave the swamps, Uncle. You're going to stay here with your friends forever. While I go back to the mainland with your money. There.
Gerald, you've killed him. You've killed him. They'll send us to prison for this.
Don't be a fool. If anyone should come looking for Uncle Jason, they won't find a trace of him.
What do you mean?
I'm going to get rid of dear Uncle Jason. Yes. Give me a hand with his body, Kitty. We're taking Uncle Jason to his friends.
Gerald, how much further do we have to carry him?
This is far enough, darling. Just set him down here.
Here? By the water's edge?
Yeah. Salute him perfectly. Strap his legs.
Yeah.
That's it. There we are.
Gerald, you aren't just going to leave him here, are you?
Why, of course, darling. Uncle Jason's friends will look after him.
His friends?
Why, yes. We'll go over there. See him swimming this way?
Alligators. Monster alligators. Gerald, they're coming up out of the water.
Yes, so they are.
Look. One of them is crawling up to Uncle Jason's body. He's going to...
Yes. Goodbye, Uncle Jason.
Our mystery will be continued in a moment. But, Dr. Weird, if you'll come over here, I have a mystery of my own.
Mystery is my business, young man.
All right, here's the clue. The number 5.
5 dead men?
Oh, no, I'm afraid you're wrong, Doctor. I'm talking about the famous Adam 5, the quality hat made of all fur felt, available at the thousands of Adam hat stores and authorized dealers all over the country for only $5. And it's far from dead. In fact, it's the liveliest number you've ever seen, mister. Why not step into an Adam hat shop and prove it to yourself? Try on your size in a famous Adam 5. Examine its snappy style, its lively color, the look of distinction. You don't have to be a master detective to see that in quality and style, an Adam is America's top hat. Now, Dr. Weird.
And now I'll finish my story, Death in the Everglades. An hour after Uncle Jason's death, Gerald and Kitty sat on Jason's dock, waiting for the guide to arrive. While they waited, Gerald tried to break open the metal cash box, but without success. Suddenly, they heard a shout.
Hello there! Sorry if I kept you folks waiting. Just hop in the dugout. We're on our way back to the mainland. It's getting dark in a few hours. You don't want to be caught in the...
What are you staring at?
That box you got there. That's the box your uncle keeps his money in. I've seen it when he's giving me money for provisions. What are you doing with it?
That's my business, and I don't have to explain it to you.
You do if you want me to take you in my dugout of the mainland.
Perhaps this will help you change your mind about that.
A gun?
Yeah. Now, if you value your life, you'll have us on the mainland within 2 hours. 2 hours, you understand? The 2 hours are almost up. Why haven't we reached the mainland? It's already dark.
It's just a small piece beyond this island we're passing.
Hear that, Kitty? In a few minutes, we'll be on the mainland.
But, Gerald, the guide will go to the local sheriff and tell him everything.
Don't you worry about the guide. I'll take care of him. That fool! Why's he gone so close to the island? Have it to ground if he doesn't
want... Gerald, he's gone. He's not in the boat.
Gone? You're right. He must have swung on an overhead branch as we were passing the island.
Gerald, there he is. He's standing in that small clearing on the island.
Find your own way to the mainland, you thieving murderers! I'll never take you there!
Oh, Gerald, what will we do without him?
Kitty, get hold of yourself. We're going to reach the mainland safely.
Oh, but how can we find our way? The sun's setting, and it's already dark here in the swamp. We may be miles from safety. Miles of these tiny winding streams. These horrible cypress trees growing together over our heads so we can't see where we're going.
Stop it, Kitty! Listen to me. We're not in any danger, do you hear me? I admit that we can't get out of the swamp tonight. But all we have to do is stay right here in the dugout until morning. When it's light again.
No, we'll never find our way out. Even the guides get lost in the Everglades sometimes. Anyway, they won't let us go. They'll stop us just like he said.
Who'll stop us?
Uncle Jason's friends. Listen to them. All around us. Waiting for us. Look there in the water. They're coming for us. The alligators.
Kitty, you mustn't say that. We're going to make it, do you hear me? We'll be rich. There's a fortune in this cash box. Okay, I'll open it for you, and then you'll see how rich we are. There's a hard lock to pick off. Maybe I can shoot it open. Kitty, the lock's broken. Kitty, look. Money.
Money?
Yeah. It's 50, 100,
150, 200, 210. I mean, there's only $210 in that box?
Yeah, but look. There's a paper in the box. It'll probably tell us where the rest of the money's hidden. Come on, let's see. It's a real estate deed. 20,000 acres. Assessed value, $1,000. No, can't be.
Oh, your uncle was a wealthy man. He had money and land. He has $210 and 20,000 acres of worthless swamp.
What? There must be more than this. There's got to be.
Stand up, Gerald. Look around you. 20,000 acres of worthless swamp. It's all yours, Gerald. And we committed murder to get it.
Kitty, sit down. Sit down, you hear me? You'll turn the dugout over.
We're lost in your vast kingdom full of snakes and alligators. Why don't you ask one of your loyal subjects how to get to the mainland? Go ahead, Gerald.
Kitty, let go.
We'll turn it over.
Kitty, are you all right?
Where are you?
Here I am, hanging on a dugout. We're over this way. Kitty, listen, church bells. They're ringing in the village church in the mainland. We can't be more than a few hundred yards from the mainland.
Yeah, that means we'll be able to reach the mainland.
Yeah. All we have to do is ride the dugout and...
Yeah. Something's about to get me.
Kitty, where are you? What happened?
No! No!
Too bad about poor Gerald and Kitty, isn't it? Such a nice young couple. But so unlucky. How were they to know that Uncle Jason's cash box contained only a few hundred dollars and a deed to some worthless swampland. And then to die in such a horrible way, only a few hundred yards from safety, in the jaws of Uncle Jason's friends, the alligators. You know, it occurs to me that perhaps Uncle Jason buried his fortune someplace in the swamp. Perhaps you'd be interested in going with me to the Everglades to search for it. Oh, you have to go now. Too bad. But perhaps you'll drop in on me again soon. I'm always home. Just look for the house on the other side of the cemetery. The house of Dr. Weird.
Hi, this is Leonard Maltin, and you're listening to The Glowing Dial with Big John and Steve here on Yesterday USA.
Thank you very much, Leonard. Hello, and welcome back, folks, to The Glowing Dial with Big John and Steve. Hope you enjoyed this strange Dr. Weird.
Yes,
episode number 5 there, The Death in the Everglades.
A lot of people are going to like Dr. Weird. Hey, you know, John, I was just thinking we're going to be having We're going to be having some new ID spots coming up soon.
Oh, yes, we got some interviews at Newark that we want to that we're going to be presenting to you. We talked to Corrine Orr. We talked to Gordon Gould. We talked to
Dick Beals,
yes, and
Will Hutchins.
Will Hutchins.
Larry Stewart.
And Larry Stevens. Yes, indeed. And we have a little thing to... we had a phone number, and we hope to do a phone interview with Joan Benny, daughter of Jack Benny. So we hope to do that in the near future. But we want to tell you how to write to us, actually, right now, folks, or to get in contact with us. There's three methods. There's a phone number, which is area code 810-774-0112, and that's Steve's line. And,
that's mine.
Leave a message if he's not in.
I'm not in a lot, so, yeah, leave a message,
you're
please.
You're not in a lot. That's, okay, that's an interesting way
it's
to put it.
It's the lot I lead.
Yes. And also there's snail mail, which is The Glowing Dial, 1055 Townhouse Lane in Traverse City, Michigan, 49686, and that is my address. And
snail mail. That's the sound of a snail.
I didn't know they made sounds. Anyway, that's the thing on the Forble board. It makes sound, okay?
It looks like a snail.
No, it doesn't. Not if you know the story. Anyway, yes. Also, there is email, which is glowdial, G-L-O-D-I-A-L, at voyager.net. And we also have a website now, folks. It is glowingdial.com, www.glowingdial.com. And we've got the archives up there, and we've got, just a whole bunch of stuff. I'm adding stuff as we speak.
Oh, it's hours and hours of viewing.
And also my vintage comedy recordings page, which is a link on the Glowing Dial page, is you can read all about my Uncle Josh project, my Cal Stewart project I'm working on.
You're not joshing us, are you?
No, I'm not.
Okay.
Some upcoming CD releases of that. We're going to get them restored with the Cedar audio restoration process and preserve these things for all time, because some of these recordings are getting to be nearly 100 years old.
That's right. And you know, so. Cedar makes your life easier.
Charlie. I have a feeling with all these bad jokes we're annoying at least one person out there. Yes. But
oh well. Say la vie.
La vie. He told me to say la vie.
Say la vie, you did.
Anyway, we're going to shut up now, folks. Thanks for tuning into The Glowing Dial. We love you out there. Write to us, call us, email us, visit the website. Fill out the guest book while you're there. Let us know you were there and what you think of the site. And any requests you may have. If we have it, we'll play it. If we don't have it, we'll find it and play it. So, until next time, this is Big John and Steve saying, keep a positive thought, keep looking up, think big, and we'll see you on the air. Bye-bye. Thank you.
yesterday.